So we were discussing outside within the team about this sentence. It is simpler to know an Upanishad than to know your thumb, your nail, the back of your hand. So if it's so simple, then why it is not understood? And then second question is that for the person, I mean, for you, it may be simple because you've known it. But for us, how will it be simple? So if I am solving a mathematical problem, I have solved it. Now, if my kid is asking me, he is not knowing the methodology.
The mathematical problem is something definite and outside of you. Let me put it this way. I have said that it is simple to know an Upanishad. Read it as whatever you can know simply is an Upanishad. Actually, we have equated an Upanishad with a particular image and form. And unless that image and form is available, we do not call the knowing the realization as an Upanishad. Whatever you can know simply is an Upanishad. If simply you stand and you look at the sky or the mountains, that is an Upanishad. If simply you can breathe, that is an Upanishad. If simply you are listening right now, this is an Upanishad. An Upanishad need not be in a particular language, in a particular form, dealing with a particular subject matter. Simplicity itself is Upanishad. The Rishi simply knows, and whatever he simply knows is called an... The Rishi simply utters, and whatever he simply utters is called an... I am fond of this particular one. And this one too comes from the Upanishads. So the students are pestering the teacher. Teacher, please tell us an Upanishad. Teacher, how about a little bit of an Upanishad? Teacher, just two lines. Teacher, just 5 minutes of Upanishad. And the teacher is fed up. These little ones are trailing him all the time. Itta sa Upanishad de do. That kind of thing. And then he says, Ukta te Upanishad. Whatever I am saying is an Upanishad. Why do you think that the Upanishad is something specific with a definite image and form? Ukta te Upanishad. Whatever I say is an Upanishad. Even if I am saying, bring me a little more dal. Even if I am saying, go and collect some wood from the jungle. That is an Upanishad. Even if I am joking, that is an Upanishad. But you are not accustomed to treating a joke as an Upanishad. So you think Upanishad is something special and will come only when there is a formal occasion and a formal setting and some kind of a language. Some kind of a definite form, shape, etc. etc. No, Ukta te Upanishad. Whatever comes simply from the teacher's mouth is an Upanishad. And who is a teacher? Who can speak simply? If you can speak simply, you too are a teacher. That simplicity itself is Upanishad. But we are used to complex forms, right? We value complexity. So when something is available simply or when something emanates simply, it does not occur to us that this is an Upanishad. You have your baby in your arms and you are cuddling it, playing with it, laughing. That's an Upanishad. You are saying silly things to your little one. That's an Upanishad. But it will never occur to you that all the silly things that you say to a six-month-old kid or to your beloved are Upanishads. They are Upanishads. All that kuchi kuing, that is Upanishad. Because it is simple. Because it is not a thing of the mind. Because it is not arising from social intervention. It is arising from a point as close to the heart as possible. Whatever arises from that point is an Upanishad. Two friends are joking with each other. light-hearted banter. Upanishad. Lovers are twisting together on the bed. Nonsensical conversation. Meaningless sounds. Upanishad. But you think Upanishad is only when the teacher is sitting in a serious and regal way and the students are all looking disciplined and serious. Only then an Upanishad takes place. Not really. The birds are chirping. Upanishad. You rush and you dive into the swimming pool and then there is that loud splash. Upanishad. Before this camp ends, you must have written at least a dozen Upanishads. We want to hear those splashes.
This thought itself relieves so much.
Now let this thought itself be relieved.
So how did you reach that state? Again, I'm talking about state, sorry. But how did you reach from that center that you look into the world in such a light way? That we cannot, and we always go, even with the simple things, we go into very seriousness.
How did you unreach it? We all are one. We start from the same point. I don't start at all. Why do you start? How did you unreach that center? I stayed where I must stay. I stay where I always am. How did you manage to run away? That is a question you must answer. I haven't done anything, so how can I answer anything about my doing? You have done a lot. You have to tell why do you keep doing a lot. People ask me, why do you keep a beard? What have I done? You do a lot of things daily. You tell me why you don't have a beard. But look at the silliness of the question. Why do you have a beard? What did I do to have a beard? Similarly, people ask me, why aren't you married? Because I was not born married. I didn't do anything. You did something. You married. You explain why you married. The onus is upon you to explain. Why did you marry? What was wrong with you that you married? What was that gnawing incompleteness that forced you into the wedding? I haven't done anything. I am just how I was 10 years back, 12 years back, right at the time of my birth, single. I wasn't born with a wife. You too weren't born with a wife. From where did you get one? And why? So enlightenment is like staying single. Or keeping a beard. Now you know why most of the so-called enlightened people are both bearded and single. Because they don't do anything. So the beard comes on its own and the wife doesn't come.
So this sense of intelligence I want.
You have it. Everybody has it. It says that you have a lot more than intelligence. Drop this obsession with moreness. Intelligence alone is sufficient. Intelligent we all are. It is just that some are intelligent plus plus. This plus plus needs to be dropped. That plus plus becomes cleverness. When you exceed your intelligence, that is called cleverness. Because intelligence itself is innocence. Anything over and above innocence is cleverness. A little more over and above that is cunningness.